is the Bristol Flyers podcast.
All right, so welcome to our next guest on the podcast. It's Josh Wilshire. Josh, how are you going?
I'm good, man. I'm good. Thanks for having me. It's always good to have a chat, so it'll be fun.
Yeah, I'm still quite surprised after the whole player announcement that you're actually a Flyers player, because so many Flyers fans will sort of remember your face as the face of Plymouth Raiders and big rivalry there over the years, and obviously now you kind of switch allegiances. How's the reaction to the signing gone down at your end?
Yeah, it's been good. I mean, that video that you put out, obviously people sort of got around it, and I guess that'll make Bristol fans like me a little bit quicker than what it probably would, because I know they probably didn't have fond memories of me over the last few years. But I've had a lot of messages. I've had a lot of positivity. So it's just good to be welcomed, you know. And that's something I was a little bit worried about, of, you know, jumping from sort of a rival in a way, you know. So no, it's good. It's good so far. I've had heaps of friend requests and you know, Instagram requests and stuff like that. So no, I'm happy so far.
Well, before we get you on the podcast, just so people can get to know you personally a bit better, know a bit more about your past, your career so far. How's your house move going? You managed to find a place in Bristol yet?
Yeah, I mean, we found some places that we like, but we just got to sell the one in Plymouth. So we got a few visits coming. To sort of see if they want them, but we just need one person just to buy, and then we can make the move fully. But everything's set up for me to be in Bristol, so it's just bringing family over now. So it'll all get there. It's just that, as you know, with the time of this world, it's just everything's taking a little bit longer. So we'll get there.
Yeah, it's been absolutely crazy, isn't it, with the whole COVID situation? Imagine lots of extra downtime for you as well.
Yeah, heaps. I mean, I got to subscribe to all the Netflix and Amazon Prime and all that stuff. I think I've got subscriptions to everything that you can subscribe to right now. So I think my bank account's taken a bit of a hit, but once it all gets back to normal, I think I'll cancel a few of them.
What are you watching at the minute?
Yeah, I'm a true crime sort of heavy guy. So if there's any sort of mystery or anything like that, I'm jumping all over it. So the podcast I'm listening to sort of Joe Rogan's one, which I'm big on at the moment as well. So anything really. It's been good the last couple of months finding things that are outside of a basketball bubble for you to be interested in, you know. So I've watched every documentary that there is to man right now. But no, it's been good. I think true crime's my sort of vice though. So that's my go-to.
Yeah, there's something I'm watching at the minute called The Fool. I think it's called The Fool on Netflix. I think it's like a crime drama's pretty good. It just seems so long ago since like The Last Dance, doesn't it, like the start of lockdown.
Yeah, I wish there was another 10 or so episodes of that was fantastic. Just drip feeding this with two a week, it was getting a bit hard, but I could watch that again, I reckon.
I kind of waited for a few weeks before starting it because I didn't want to watch like two episodes and then have to wait a week for another two. So I think I waited till about 3 to 4 weeks into it actually coming out, and I binged it all completely at the end.
Yeah, I sort of wish I did that. I was just waiting at the 8 a.m. time slot when it would release, and then I'd be loading it up. So I should have took it a bit easier.
And obviously NBA back up and running now as well. I imagine you're on the league pass.
I got that. I got them all, mate. Everything you can think of, I got it.
It's quite good to have the games on at a sort of half-decent time now, this NBA restart, I think. Like, you get like a 7 or 8 p.m. tip-off, and normally it's all in the early hours of the morning.
Yeah, that's it. I had Sky in Plymouth, so I was taping them, but now it's like back-to-back, so I just can't stop watching it all, so it's been good.
How long's it been since you've had a summer off of like completely no basketball? Because I know, kind of similar to Mike Vigor when he used to play for us, that you guys do the winter season over here in the UK, and then you go over to Australia and you do like their winter season out in our summer. How long has it been since you really had that time to kind of sit back and kind of unwind?
Yeah, I think it's probably 8 years or so. I think I got injured 8 years ago with my Achilles, and that was the only time that I had off. So it's been hard going back and forth, but when you go home and play, you're only sort of training as a team 2 to 3 times a week, and then you're doing the individual stuff. So it's not as heavy of a workload as what the BBL season is. So it works really well, but it's been good to have a few months just to sort of reset the batteries a little bit so that I'm ready to go come this season.
How does it normally work in terms of your time scale? So what kind of time scales are we talking about? Say you finish a BBL season in March, April time. how quick's the turnaround then to the end of the BBL season to the start of the Seabull season, for example?
Yeah, so when, like me and Viggs, when we used to play in Seabull, they used to start in March. So we'd used to miss maybe 6 or 7 games, and that it was just harder for teams to sign you because I think the games were only 19, like there was only 19 games in the season, you know. So to ask a club to take you and miss 6, it was too many. So I started playing in the QBL, which is now the NBL 1 North, and they don't start until basically the end of April. So usually I've only missed 1 to 2 games. I think my last team in Townsville, they let me have a couple of weeks off after the end of the season. So I think I only missed 4 or 5 games. So it sort of starts, the one I play in, it starts at the end of April and goes to about the end of August. So you got maybe 2 weeks either side. So it's enough time to recoup a little bit, but you are going back and forth.
Is that a good thing for you or a bad thing, sort of having no time really? Do you like to just keep going straight through, or do you kind of like to have that time to recuperate and maybe have almost an off season where you can maybe work on things that you wouldn't normally work on in season?
Yeah, I mean, that's the beauty of going back home and playing, is that, as I said, you only train a couple of times a week. So for the other stuff that you're doing, you are working on things that for your main season, which is the BBL one, that you find your weaknesses or whatever. So you can still work on all that stuff. But for me, I just like keeping busy and I like playing basketball. That's the main thing. So I'm fortunate enough to be able to go home and play. So for as long as my body lets me, I'm going to keep trying to do it.
So I kind of want to crack on and talk about your basketball career. I mean, I've done some research. You've played all over the world in terms of out in Australia, in the UK, in Germany. And we'll start from the very beginning, I guess. I mean, you grew up playing in Australia. When was it that you first discovered basketball, and when did you find out that you could actually go quite far with it?
Yeah, I mean, I've always loved basketball. My first PE teacher back home was like a local coach and like a sort of a smaller men's player, like in one of the lower leagues. So he got me into it. And then from there, I fell in love, you know, like everyone that sort of plays basketball, they just have a passion. You just keep playing. And where I'm from in Melbourne, basketball is massive. You know, there's a big culture for junior clubs and for developing players and sort of going up a pathway towards being a professional. There's probably not that many people that make it, so I'm fortunate enough to have done. But coming from a breeding ground like Melbourne, when it comes to basketball, you're very fortunate with the coaches and the facilities and all that stuff you have. So I started there. I worked through the ranks of like making state teams, and then I played for Australia when I was younger, like and it's called a FIBA Oceania tournament. So it was pretty cool to sort of, you know, experience that. And then, yeah, I just tried to keep cracking into the men's team at my local club, which was Sandringham, and finally got there and then sort of kicked on from there.
Were there like other sports you were playing as a kid too, or is it mainly just basketball? I know there's Australia are big on some of the other sports out there as well.
Yeah, I played Aussie rules football. So I played it in school, and then I played 1 year for a club. But mum was a bit funny about me playing footy. She knew I liked basketball and she just didn't want me to get hurt, I think. So I guess I'm a little baby. She just wanted to protect me. So I only dabbled in a bit of footy, but for the most part, basketball was sort of my only thing.
You mentioned obviously about the end goal for players to play at. You see more and more Aussie players now playing in the NBA. NBL has sort of been growing at a rapid rate. So I'd say over the last 10 years or so, it's completely transformed. Was that always your goal as a player then, to go play the NBL, or did you always have NBA ambitions, or where did you want to play as a kid?
Yeah, so when I was younger, so I'm a 91 born, so in the 90s, the NBL was booming. Like, it was massive. You had packed crowds. It was on TV. It was everywhere, you know, and you had guys like Andrew Gaze. That was sort of their prime. That's one of our best, probably the best player ever from Australia. And I was a Melbourne Tigers fan, so I only ever wanted to play in the NBL, and that was the dream. I never thought about the NBA. I think it's kids should think about that, but it's a tough dream to sort of try and get over there, you know. So I wanted to play in the NBL. That was my dream forever. Follow the team, the Tigers, and yeah, I mean, you play against a lot of kids, but you sort of never really think you're going to get there. But as you get older and you start to get a little bit better, you think, oh, you know, it's within my reach almost. I could probably get there. I've just got to make a couple more teams. I've got to play a little better, and then it's there. So I was fortunate enough to have a season with the Tigers as a development player. So I was just like one of the young kids. But no, it was good. Like, I got there. I only played a couple of games, but, you know, it's good to say that I did make it, I guess.
Was that before or after you had your kind of spell at Central Wyoming? Did you go to junior college first and then kind of come back and then work your way into that NBL team?
Yeah, so what happened was I graduated high school and then I wanted to go to college. So I had a Division II school called Metro State who gave me an offer, and that's where a lot of Australians have gone. So for you to say sort of Metro State back home, there's a lot of prestigious Australians that have made the Olympic teams and played NBL careers that have gone to that school, so it's a big deal. So I wanted to go there, but my grades came out from high school and I just didn't have enough grades to get in, unfortunately. So that coach got me into a junior college, which was Central Wyoming. And then I went over there for a year and I got injured. I broke my foot, I think, in the first maybe 2 months, just after preseason, before the season started. So I basically sat out that whole time. So I came home and I signed with Santa Ann Sabres in the Seabull, and I was a backup then as well to one of the old professional guys who was in the NBL. And from there, I tried out for the Tigers position through one of my old coaches. He just got an assistant coach job there. So I tried out, made it through a bunch of the tryouts, and then they asked me to be a part of it. So it was a weird sort of, I don't know, maybe 12, 18 months where I was injured, I was down, I wasn't playing. Then all of a sudden, you know, I've got a spot where I've always wanted.
How do you kind of prepare mentally for that? Because obviously, you know, you've always wanted to play in NBL. You've had to sit out for so long and then you work your way back up to full fitness and then straight away kind of thrown into that situation where as a development player, you'd have to really impress to really push into that first team.
Yeah, exactly. I mean, I was 20. So like I was just a kid in a way, you know, like basketball wasn't really the be all and end all, but I knew I wanted to be a basketball player. So I was still just having fun with it. I was just trying to learn, get better, learn from the older guys and just be a sponge. So being injured, it was just more annoying than anything else because I was like, oh, I just want to play basketball. And I finally got back and I got to a spot where, you know, I am a development player and I get a chance to learn every day from guys that have spent 10 years in the NBL, 6, 5 years in the NBL, you know. And that season was the NBA lockout. So Patty Mills, who I'm sure everyone knows, came and he signed for our team. So I got probably 2 months of just getting my butt kicked from him, basically, you know. And that's sort of... that stuff you can't pay for, that sort of learning environment, you know?
Yeah, I mean, you say it, like, him being on your team, it's not about the, you know, just being teammates, but the fact that you're going at each other every single practice, I mean, that must have been amazing for your development.
Yeah, I mean, there was one time where, so we played the scrimmage, and as a development player, basically there's 10 signed guys and then there's one or two development players, so... for the most part, when you're gearing up, so if you're going from Monday to Friday, probably on Monday and Tuesday, you have the most of your workload because the older guys and the pros are sort of easing into the week. But when there's injuries, which there was a lot, I got to sort of have the full week where I could play. And it was gearing up to a game on a Saturday, and this was on a Thursday, and I got to play in the 5-on-5. So I was one of the 10. I was just at training, but I'm like, this is fantastic. You know, I get to go against Patty. Anyway, I came off an on-ball screen, and he was defending me. And I went to shoot it, and I made the shot, and I'm like, this is great. Like, how good am I? I just made a shot. And he lands on my foot and rolls his ankle, and everyone just stops. And I didn't realize, but I was just like, hey, like, I'm a big dog. I just made a shot against Patty Mills. And then I look on the ground, and he's lying there holding his ankle, and I'm just like, oh, my God, because I'm not ready to play. I'm just there to train. And everyone's looking at him like, this is the multi-million dollar man, and he's just landed on your ankle. So I drove home from training, like, with super mixed emotions because I trained well, but I feel like I just injured the franchise player for our team.
I mean, how did it all go down? Well, how bad was the injury?
I think he missed. I don't know if he played that game. He definitely missed a few trainings, but because I didn't talk to everyone until the next day at training. So that next 24 hours, I was just like, what have I done? Like, is it my fault? Is it, you know, because it's an accident, but at the same time, it's like, you feel responsible, you know. So it was a bit of a weird circumstance.
So you had that amazing experience, even though, you know, injuring Paddy Mills wasn't probably the best experience, but you had that, you know, amazing experience of being a development player. And then what happens next? Do you play another Seabull summer season just to sort of keep that game shape up?
Yeah, so I was on a one-year deal as a development player. So I signed for my same my same club, my same Siebel team at the time, which was Sandringham and Sabres. And so the year before I played Siebel and our backup, I was backup to an NBL point guard. He actually ruptured his Achilles during that season for another team. So the starting spot was open for Sandringham. So I said, look, I'll play. This is my home club. I want to play there. I had a really good year. I won Youth Player of the Year, like Under 23 Player of the Year, which is a pretty big thing over there. But with four games to go, I ended up rupturing my Achilles. And on that same week, Tigers said that they wanted me back for a second year as a development player, which I was ecstatic about. And then I ended up rupturing my Achilles, and they got rid of me, obviously. So it was a tough year for sure. I had my surgery pretty much straight away, so that was fortunate. And they said, look, it'll be about 12 months. And in your head, 12 months is a long time, you know. So I was thinking, I'll get back early. I'm young, you know, I'm fit. I'll be able to do all that. But it was probably 15 months before I actually felt myself, you know. I think I was back playing basketball after 10 or 11, which is pretty good. But movement-wise and confidence and just doing the same movements that happened when you ruptured it, it takes so long mentally to get over that sort of hurdle. So I want to say maybe 15 months, probably when I got to Reading was when I started feeling myself again a little bit.
And then obviously you said it there, like you head to Reading. How does that work out? I mean, it's such a random change to go from one side of the world all the way to the other side of the world and then come and play in NBL Division One.
Yeah, so the week that I did my Achilles, I got my British passport in the mail. So on that week, I got my British passport. I got Tigers told me that they wanted me back, and then at the end of the week, I ruptured my Achilles. So I went from feeling like I have this European passport, I've got, you know, a pro team wanting me, and then I ruptured my Achilles. I went through all the emotions, and then during my Achilles rehab, I was sort of working out my options. So I obviously didn't have anything from the NBL because I was out. I reached out to a couple of coaches who had links in England, and one of them, a Siebel coach, actually was like an old coach for Reading Rockets. He used to do community coaching and that. So I messaged him and I said, look, do you have any links over there? And he sort of hit up Reading, and then they told me that I could come over and play. So I went from the NBL to EBL Division One, which is a random sort of circumstance, you know, but I flew myself over. I wasn't getting paid to play basketball. I was paying Reading rent to live there throughout the season. So like, it was a massive gamble that I had to take on myself to try and do that. But I was young and I just wanted to play basketball.
I mean, it was a gamble that certainly paid off. I mean, you absolutely dominated the league. Was it like 23 points per game, I think you had, and won league MVP as well. Was that the year you guys won the treble? Did you win the cup and the trophy and the league as well?
Yeah, and we won three of the trophies, and then we lost in the grand final of the playoffs to Leeds. So we almost took all four, really, which would have been great. But no, we had a great season. So it was sort of a surprise. I knew that I could play in that league because of where I've come from, but no one knew me. So it was just good to get over there and just start having fun again playing basketball, you know. Like it was uplifting because of all the experience that I went through probably the last 12 to 15 months with being injured. So injuries take so much out of you mentally. So to finally get back on court, and I'm in another country where I don't even know anyone, you know, it was a bit random, but I just got to have fun. I got to play basketball. I got to live in a different country. So I tried to see the positives and all that stuff instead of thinking of where I was, you know, before I got injured. So I just tried to embrace sort of the positives in a way.
And that was a really stacked team as well, that Div 1 team. I remember, I mean, like players like Lewis Champion, for example, sort of being on that team as well. What do you remember about kind of your fellow teammates that year?
Yeah, I mean, well, it started because we had a really good coach. We had Manuel, who's now an ACB assistant coach in Spain. So, I mean, he was fantastic. Then you had Lewis, obviously, he was on the team. We had Liam Carpenter, who's playing in Germany. He's like on a BBL side in Germany, which is their top league. We had Danny Carter, who's a sort of an all-time BBL player, and he went to Division One college. We had four or five Spaniards on our team. We were just stacked, and we beat a few BBL teams in pre-season and during the season. So we did really well.
Did you guys enter the BBL trophy that year, or did they not invite BBL?
Yeah. We lost to Sheffield, I think. I think we lost by 6 or 8 to Sheffield. But we beat Plymouth, actually. We beat Surrey United, I think they were called at the time. I think we beat Surrey United 3 or 4 times in pre-season. So I think we only lost to Worcester by 6, and I think they might have won a cup or something that year. So yeah, we had a pretty good team, and we just seemed to gel with each other.
Yeah, I think the gap between Div 1 and BBL in terms of playing ability is definitely getting closer year on year. I mean, we experienced it firsthand with what Solent can do. Worthing as well, making that run in the trophy. The talent level is getting a lot closer to the BBL, and you could easily see the BBL, you know, allowing some of these teams in further down the line. I think it's just a few minor details like venue and stuff that's preventing them from really, and funding that's really preventing them from making the step up.
Yeah, it's tough because when you're in the EBL, like a lot of your guys work full time, and then if you're sort of a mediocre British player in the EBL, the BBL is probably too far of a jump. But if you're a good EBL player, you can definitely play in the BBL. But then if you're not getting paid full time to be in the EBL, and then you jump to the BBL, you're going to have to give up a lot to sort of make it work, you know. So there's a lot of guys in the EBL that can play in the BBL, but due to work, having jobs, having families, it's just no point moving across country for however much a month when you're sort of like you're losing out, you know. But realistically, there's a lot of BBL players that are good enough to play in the BBL for sure.
Yeah, a lot of our players have come through from Div 1. You've mentioned like Lewis and Rafael and players like Chris Taylor as well, even like Greg Street, Roy Owen, who you would have played against during your time at Reading. Again, all just coming up through from Div 1 playing in the BBL at that level.
Yeah, I mean, if those Div 1 teams have BBL teams, then I think a lot of them will do really well, you know. But if you're an aspiring BBL player, I guess, and you're trying to jump from the EBL, there's a lot of stuff you've got to give up to try and make that dream come true, you know. And depending on what clubs offer you, it's just so difficult. Like for me, I didn't have anything. As I said, I paid my way over to Reading. I wasn't getting paid to play basketball. So for me to jump to a BBL team, it was easy, you know. But for guys that are playing in the EBL and they have jobs and security, it's very difficult because, as you know, the BBL, the player turnover is massive. So you've got to be in a good situation to sort of make this work.
And then I guess you were able to make it work in terms of making that jump from Div 1 into the BBL. You mentioned you played a few BBL teams during your time in Reading, so I imagine a lot of coaches had eyes on you at the time. Did you have quite a few offers on the table from BBL clubs the following season?
Yeah, well, when I got my British passport, I emailed everybody. So before I spoke to the Siebel coach about coming to England, I emailed every BBL team through Facebook and everything, emails, everything I could get off Eurobasket. No one wanted me. Not even any EBL teams wanted me. It was only because of that link with the coach that I got a spot. So from then, when you have a good year like I did at Reading, I had a few teams, I think probably three or four BBL teams that asked me to come and play for them. And then our first game as a preseason game for Reading was against Plymouth, and we actually won. I played really well. I think we won by a point at the buzzer. So in about January or February, I think their coach, Jay Marriott, is a good friend of mine. He reached out and said, "Hey, you know, what do you want to do next season? Do you want to come play for Plymouth?" And I just loved the atmosphere there. So I thought, yeah, absolutely, get me on board.
What were your first impressions of the BBL as a whole? I mean, it's the first time you were playing in that league, wasn't it?
Yeah, I mean, I've played against a few teams, but it's different when you play them at Reading than when you go into their place with all their fans and they're screaming out, yeah, and stuff like that, you know. So, like, the league I love. I think the league's fantastic. I think there's a lot of ground where the league could get better. But it was more the player turnover and the management side of stuff, which was a real letdown for me my first couple of years there, because I had probably 15 different teammates in two seasons, and like that's crazy. These are guys' livelihoods, and I understand making changes, but at the same time, guys were getting cut after playing good games, and it's just like this life. Like we don't get paid enough to be able to sort of just bounce back like that. You know, we're not football players, so to see guys their lives upheld, and it's tough. It's tough when your teammates sort of go through that stuff, you know.
Yeah, I remember that season. There was so many. Just from an outsider looking in, there was so much turnover in that Plymouth team. And I was just sort of thinking, like, how can you put results together as a team on the floor if you've literally got different teammates alongside you each and every week? And you can't just find that chemistry straight away. It's got to come from playing together, and you go through those losses and that builds chemistry to turn them into wins.
Yeah, I mean, it seemed like we just wanted, from the ownership point of view, we just wanted to get as, like, the best players we could, put them on the court and then see what happens, you know. But then you play teams like Newcastle and Leicester who are the top teams at that time when I first came into the league, and they've got guys that they've had for 4 or 5 years, you know. And it's like, that's obviously the recipe for success, is to get guys that want to be there, for one, guys that you're going to re-sign each year and can develop, and then you go from there, instead of like chopping and changing every 5 seconds to try and get success. You know, you might get lucky 1 year and get 1 year where it all clicks, but it's not sustainable, you know. So I think, as you see with Leicester and the Newcastles, they're at the top every year for that exact reason.
What was it like being on the inside of that and just sort of having to almost play for your job each week, I guess, because you never know, like, you could be next if you don't have a good game?
Yeah, there's a lot of times where I thought I was next, because I'd rolled my ankle. I had really bad ankle troubles that year. So, like, I missed a couple of games and I was playing injured, and I was like, my time is up for sure. And it's tough because it almost stops you from getting along with some of your teammates, because it seems like everyone's – it's like a dog-eat-dog, and they're meant to be your brothers, you know? Like, so it wasn't until I played a few more seasons where I realised that's not how it's meant to be. Like, you're meant to be a really tight-knit group, and you're meant to have the same vision, instead of being jealous of a teammate who plays better than you, or getting into little bickerings because, you know, you're just worried about your job. So it wasn't a very good environment, but for the most part, you learn a lot from it.
It just felt like there was a lot going on there behind closed doors, and like players leaving, players coming in, and I can't imagine what that would have been like on the inside from your point of view either.
Yeah, no, it's not fun. It's tough because you have the idea of being in a professional league, of what it should be like, and it wasn't like that, you know. So as I said, like, you can only look at the top teams and look at why they're there and how their management do it and how their roster's structured and all of that stuff. And I think the lower teams can learn a lot from that. And I think the BBL's got better. I think the player turnover is probably less, which is good. But back then I think it was the early 2010s sort of area, 2012 maybe, it seemed like there was more changes than there were signings, and that's just crazy.
Yeah, obviously a lot going on off the court. So you eventually decide to leave after 2 years in that first spell of with Plymouth. And what's going through your head at this point? What happens next?
Yeah, so I was done with Plymouth, and then I didn't have a team to go back to in Australia either. So I was sort of in a middle ground where I didn't really know what was going to happen. Then Townsville, a team back home, reached out to me, and they had an NBL team at the time, and they were like, you know, if you played well here, you might be able to get a backup spot in the NBL. So I was like, this is it, you know, this is my chance to get back in. So I signed for them. When I got there, about 3 weeks later, their NBL team folded. So I was like, I'm playing here, there's no chance of me playing in the NBL. Like, this is, it just seems like nothing's meant to be for me, you know, like, I just can't catch a trick. So I played there for 4 years. I ended up being one of the best, probably the best club that I've played for in terms of structure, professionalism, all of that stuff. You know, I just love my time there. We ended up winning 2 championships in back to back, and I just can't speak highly enough of it, you know. But it's a shame that the NBL stuff didn't work out, because that would have been a fantastic opportunity for me to try and crack back into the league.
Some familiar faces in the BBL obviously go out there as well. I think you played with the same team as Jamel Anderson 1 year.
Yeah, I did. I think he, 2 years actually, this last spell, he came out again. So Rashad Asani, obviously Deuce from Plymouth, he played out there. I played against Dante, who used to play at Plymouth as well. It was Tyrone Lee, I think, he played for Bristol. He was out there. So there's that's what I'm saying. It's a small world. You're going to run into guys all over the shop, you know. So there's a lot of BBL players that have played in, or imports mostly, that have played in the Seabull and the Big V and the QBL. So, yeah, it's a pretty good league to sort of bounce back and forth.
Yeah, it's crazy, isn't it, how you think the basketball world is massive, but really it is quite a small network, isn't it? Someone's played with someone who's been on the same team as someone else at some point, and it just comes up in conversation, and all of a sudden all these players are linked somehow.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, I think the relationships you form are really important, because if you're trying to get into a team, someone will know someone that played against you or played with you or something. So there's no point being an ass to anyone. You know, you gotta form good relationships and be a genuine person, because otherwise it's just going to come back to bite you down the road.
And so you obviously have your first season with Townsville, and that was a very successful year, as you say. And then Cheshire Phoenix pops up.
Yeah, so I once again, I was in Townsville. I was playing really well, but I didn't have a club to go to. So we went on this road trip to Rockhampton, which is like the biggest road trip that we have for a Townsville club, and that's like 10-12 hours on a bus, so it's quite a long one. So we played there, we're on our way back, and all of a sudden my phone rings. I think it's like 3 a.m. Australian time, 1, 2 or 3 a.m. Australian time, and I'm like, what is this? And then looks like Cheshire wanted me, and I had nothing else. I was like, this is it, you know, like I'm back in the BBL, it's going to be a good chance. So I signed there and just sort of went with it, you know. I was excited to be back in the BBL because I like the league and I like England, so it was a good fit at the time.
How do you look back on that experience? I mean, I think you only played like 13 games, I think it was.
Yeah, it was a shame because I didn't get to finish out the season. I broke my foot. So it seems like every story I've got an injury or something, but it's just one of those things, you know, with basketball. So I played, 13, 15 games or something. And we had a coaching change. We had a bunch of player changes as well. So it's just those early days, mate. It just seemed like all my teammates were changing. Coaches were changing. I think I had three or four different coaches in my first 3 years of the BBL. And then you probably have 20 different players, you know, teammates that you have. So Cheshire was a fun time in terms of getting to know the fans. I still keep in touch with some people from there, so it's good to have relationships from there, but it's just a shame how it all sort of spiraled out.
And then you returned to fitness again. Did you play another season in Townsville? Were you fit in time again to play for Townsville?
Yeah, so I think the foot took me probably 2 months, I guess, to heal. It was a stress fracture, so I went back to Townsville. We actually won the championship that year, and then I got signed to play in Germany. So I went over to the Pro B in Germany, and I played against a guy that I went to college with in Central Wyoming, actually. So it's like, that's what I mean. It's a tiny, tiny world, you know. You're just playing in a random area in Germany, and you see friends, you know. So it's pretty cool. But that was a really fun year, you know. I wanted to play somewhere where I couldn't speak the language, and that I, you know, it was going to be out of my comfort zone. So we had a pretty good year. The team made the playoffs again, and they hadn't made the playoffs in a few years, so it was a success from that point of view. But we got knocked out first round to the team that went on to win, unfortunately. But it was fun, really good year.
What's that like when you rock up to a team and you don't speak the same language as the coaching staff? You've got lots of players speaking different languages on different teams. What's that experience like for you? I imagine it's quite a strange one.
Yeah, it was weird to start with because as the German guys, like a lot of my teammates spoke English, which was good, so I could talk to them. But obviously when they're just talking to each other, it's in German. So a lot of the time you're just sort of standing there having no idea if they're talking about you or if they're, you know, like what they're saying. Like the coach, he was American, but he's been in Germany forever, basically. So he was fluent in German, so he could talk to us. But it's weird when you want to have a conversation with someone, but the dialect, I guess, sort of gets lost sometimes.
As a point guard as well, that's the probably the biggest part of your role is communication with your teammates. And then I guess you had hand signals or whatever it was to sort of dictate the plays, I guess.
Yeah, I had our backup point guard was a German guy, and he had to help me a lot with trying to get on the same page as everyone else, because that's it. Like we'd be in a huddle and I'd be screaming all this stuff and probably one other person would know what I'm talking about, which would be the other American or Australian guy, you know? So it was very difficult.
And obviously you have that season out in Germany, and then what kind of happens next? Obviously you have that second spell in Plymouth, but this time obviously brand new ownership, brand new head coach, and it seems like everything's changed in terms of the way the club's being run now.
Yeah, I mean, I went back. I was excited to go back. It was a couple of the guys, Richard and Ross. I knew Ross more than Richard back in my previous time at Plymouth, and they obviously took over from Bob, who was the previous owner, and they tried to change the club, you know, which is great. They brought in a more professional approach, and it seemed like everything was sort of going in the right direction. I think now they are with new partnerships with this Turkey thing, that they're going to go in the right direction. But my first year of this last spell was really good because we kept predominantly the same core, you know, like we had our same group basically all season. We made it to the semi-finals of the league, which is great, you know. We got the club back to the playoffs after I think 8 years or something it was, so it was really good, you know. But we weren't able to retain Dante, which really killed us, because he was, in my opinion, he was the MVP of the league that year. He didn't come back through various reasons. And then we sort of had to start again. You know, we recruited a bunch of guys from college. We had a whole new team. We kept myself and Deuce and a couple of young guys, but player turnover and the new ownership coming in and sort of signing different guys who they wanted to see if they could keep for the following season. So it was just a bit of a hiccup. But for the most part, it is a completely different experience to what the last time at Plymouth was.
Yeah, I remember that first year of your second spell, and the league was absolutely crazy that year. I mean, there was literally two games separating fourth right the way down to ninth, and Flyers just finished it outside in that ninth spot. But it came down to the last weekend, and I think with you guys in Plymouth, I think there was a game or something which if you'd won, you would have finished like fourth, and then if not, you would have finished down in eighth or something like that. The league was mad.
Yeah, that's it. We went to Glasgow, and if we had a beat, then we finished fourth, and we were guaranteed eighth because I think you guys, Bristol, lost the week before, so it guaranteed us a spot, but we could only finish fourth or eighth, which is just random. You know, you can't finish anywhere else. So we lost to Glasgow and then had to play London in the first round, but we beat them, luckily. So, yeah, it's good when the league's that close. You know, you want the league to be like that. I think when I first came in, the year before I started playing in the BBL, I think Birmingham went 0-36 or something, you know. And it's like, you don't want that. You want teams competitive. You want every game to be like good, you know. Like for a fan, you want to be able to watch that. So I think that was my most enjoyable season because every game you had to get up for. There was no easy beats. And I hope the league can get back to that this year.
I remember there being a game against Plymouth, actually, away that year, and it went to overtime or something, and it was crazy, and it was one of those Raiders intense atmospheres, and there was so much at stake, and I think you guys came out on top in the end in that one.
Yeah, we did. I think we were tied on the ladder, I think, it must have been the third game of the series, so whoever won that got the head-to-head.
Yeah,
that's why it was so massive, and then I think you guys jumped us early, and then we ended up coming back, and then it went to overtime, and we ended up getting you really late. I think someone missed a three sort of to tie it or win it on the buzzer. So it was a great atmosphere. But, you know, I think we've had some really good battles with Bristol. I know when I first came in, Bristol seemed to beat us all the time. We just couldn't get them. It was like every other team in the league we'd do okay against, but Bristol kept beating us. And then the last couple of years, it's been real even, which has been fun to be a part of.
Yeah, so many memories from these like Southwest derbies. I remember that one game we were on about with the overtime loss. That was the time I interviewed Andreas after the game, and it was the famous line, "They didn't win it, but we lost it" line, and it came back to bite us in the butt afterwards a few weeks down the line. And I remember that video as well.
Yeah, I remember that. I remember seeing it on Twitter. Everyone was retweeting it and that. But that's the sort of stuff you love about rivalries like that, you know, is the heat of the moment stuff and the passion. And Andreas, like, there's no one that cares more about Bristol Flyers than Andreas, obviously, you know. And then Plymouth, there's so many passionate people there that care just as much about Plymouth. So it's good to have that back and forth as long as it stays within its realm, you know. You don't want anything to cross lines, but it's good to have that passion and that competitiveness in the BBL for sure.
When Flyers first joined the league, I think we were like 6-0, I think it was, against Plymouth. And it was the seventh game and Plymouth, it was down in Plymouth. And I think we had like another trolley tweet to put out. And it wasn't actually that bad from our point of view. Like, it was like a you know, it was a bit of harmless fun on social media. And I think the tweet was something like, here's highlights from the last time that Plymouth beat Bristol in the BBL. And obviously they hadn't beaten us. So I took like a YouTube screenshot and it was like, this video does not exist. And then I remember the next game, we played Plymouth again a few weeks later, and the Plymouth Herald picked up on the tweet and they wrote a story in the Herald, like the headline of the story was "Raiders out to avenge Flyers mean tweet." And as a media team, we're like, yeah, that's it, job done, that's a storyline created around this game that we can use to help sell tickets. And I think, like, you're right, like, these, although, like, there's so much respect between the two teams on the court, and they like to battle, and they go hard at each other, and it's great to watch. But adding, like, these things, like, these sort of storylines, I think it's what the league needs. It's to create these rivalries between teams, to build storylines, because that's what's going to engage the fans, and that's ultimately what's going to sell tickets for each club.
Yeah, exactly. And the thing that I really liked about it, like, obviously, I was always on the Plymouth side. So having to go up against Greg Street, having to go up against the Dozy, those guys like that who have been wearing the Bristol uniform for forever, it seems, in my mind. You know, like I versed Greg back in EBL days and I had to deal with him in all the BBL days. You know, Daniel Dozy, same thing. Like when I think of Bristol Flyers, I think of those guys because they're always there, and that's what makes the rivalry and the passion like a lot more intense, because those guys care about who they're playing for. Like I cared about playing for Plymouth back in those days, you know. So we always wanted to beat them, but there was never disrespect. There's always respect there, but at the same time, like, it just made it so much deeper, because it's not like there's 10 new guys versing each other all the time. It's the same guys. It's the same battle. It's the same talk all the time. So it's good. You know, I remember this year we played Bristol, and I remember actually it might have been last season. Yeah, it would have been. So I think we Beach is really good at Plymouth, and we were like we can really beat these guys. There's no trouble. And we jumped here straight away. And then Daniel Adozi, towards the end of the game, was just started talking, getting real aggressive. And he was so passionate. He's like, you just wait till you come to our place. You wait till you come to our place. And I think we played him in the next couple of weeks. And we went down there and you guys just battered us. It was just like, that was exactly what we needed, you know, to sort of set our season to go forward, because we needed to feel like we weren't the number one dog, because we had so much confidence in ourselves. But I love that he was so passionate about it, and that's why I'm excited to play with someone like that, you know, because he cares.
Yeah, there's so many great memories. I know that there was one game, I think it was the Hamid. I don't know if you were here for this one. There's a couple of memories I've got here. One of them was Hamid Ali throwing LVC Dusha into the A-frame. I don't know if that was your season
no,
or not.
Well, I remember watching that on YouTube, actually.
that one got pretty tense. And I remember just like looking down and I was like, there's no way I can actually cover this on social. But it literally, I think I put it into like a promo video or something to promote the rivalry for the next game or something like that. And there was another game, I think, I don't know if this was the year that you were playing, but we were up by like six at home at SGS with like 10 seconds left. And it was just a case of run out the clock, job done. And I think Daryl Coletto like knocks down a three and then gets the steal and knocks down another three and forces OT. And then we lose that game. I don't know. Were you there for that season?
No, I wasn't. No, I think that was the same season. Yeah, I remember watching that game actually. So that's what I mean. There's so much passion between the two clubs. It's good. It's always going to be like that, which is because of the proximity between the two clubs. So hopefully this coming season, you know, being on the other side of it, it's going to be the same. There's going to be passion. There's going to be respect. But at the same time, you want to beat them.
What do you think your reaction will be when you go back to the pavilions? Do you think you'll get booed? I know Mike Vigor got a lot of boos from the Plymouth Raiders fans.
He did. Yeah, I was surprised about that, because Viggs is a likeable guy. If anyone knows Viggs, you know, there's no reason to boo him. But I don't know. I mean, I have a lot of good relationships with people in Plymouth, so I'm sure there'll be some cheers at least, but there'll probably be the passionate fans that will boo me. But that's part of basketball, isn't it? Just like injuries are, people not liking you is also part of basketball.
So when the fixtures come out and whenever that may be, is that going to be one of the games that you circle straight away? Is that the one you're looking out for?
I don't know. I mean, I'm excited to play him because it's something new, but I just want to be back playing after these last 6 months, it feels like. You know, I'll play anyone. Just put me against five guys from the park, I'll just play, you know. So I think every game will have a circle when you have such a big layoff.
Yeah. So that takes us up to today. That's essentially where the Flyers' journey starts. Do you remember that first call or that first text from Andreas? How did that kind of play out?
Yeah, we've been pretty close. I've been pretty close to signing for Bristol like a couple of times, really. You know, it just hasn't worked out. So since I've known him for however many years now, since the EBL days, I knew that, you know, I can talk to him if the situation came up. So it was really good to hear that he wanted me to be a part of it and be a big part of Bristol. So, you know, I'm just looking forward to joining and meeting everyone and being around the guys that have been Bristol Flyers for the last couple of years. You know, they've got a really good culture, and Andreas is a really good coach, which I think I'll learn something from, which is the biggest thing. I'm 29, I'm nearly 30, but I still want to learn basketball, and I think Andreas will be able to teach.
I think one of the biggest things for me as like a member of staff working at the club is that there's a real ambition for the future for Flyers. Like, there's a plan exactly where they want to be with the new arena coming on board. And I think that's going to be the game changer for Flyers, because, I mean, you remember it. Like, you would have seen what it's like 5-6 years ago playing for Reading against Bristol, and there not being many fans in the crowd. And then 6 years down the line, complete sellouts at SGS since kind of Bristol Sport came involved, and 2 to 3 years down the line, that's going to be really exciting. And I think that's, for me, what I'm looking forward to most.
Yeah, I mean, it's like, as you said, the EBL days, there was really no one there. You know, there was probably like the wives and partners and all that stuff of the guys that were playing in the crowd, and that was about it. And then you play them in the BBL, and there was really good turnouts. But from their first year in the BBL to now, it seems like the passion's just got so much more intense, you know, because the guys that, I think my first year, like, they were, there was a big crowd, they were clapping, it was good. Now you go there, it's a super hostile environment, it's fun to play it, you know. You've got kids, like the academy kids, whoever they are on the baseline, they're yelling at you, you know. You've got fans that know basketball a little bit more now, so they've got a bit more behind them to sort of gear you on when you're not playing well. So I think when Bristol do get their bigger arena, they're just going to pack it, because the passion that the Flyers fans have shown in my time over here, I think if you build a bigger stadium, more people will come, you know. So it's exciting for Bristol Flyers, and hopefully I can be a part of that as I get older and move into that next part of my career.
What about the league as a whole? Kind of how have you, talk about how the Flyers have developed as a club, but how have you seen the league develop over these last 5 years?
Yeah, it's good to see the, sort of the teams that were at the bottom when I first came in sort of pick up a little bit, you know. Like Surrey now, when we played them at Reading, they were not very good, you know. And now they're signing imports, they're signing guys that have really good players, they're getting good British players, they're building up. Same with Manchester, you know. I think they never had imports when I first came into the league, and then a couple of years ago they first signed their import. Now they're signing 4 imports, I think they've already announced. So it's good that the lower teams are coming up. And I think with teams going into Europe, you know, London, Leicester have doubled in there, Newcastle maybe with their new arena, you know, it's great. I think there's a lot of negativity with the league that I see on Twitter and stuff, people talking all this stuff. But at the same time, it's like, we need to G this league up, you know. We need to make sure that it's professional, that the guys are professional, that the league is, as a whole, it's sort of ticking boxes to be compared really well to those teams in Europe. So I think with teams being in Europe and teams having their own arena, I think that's going a long way for it.
Yeah, I see. I think I read an article a little while ago, but the development of the BBL compared to the development of the NBL in Australia and how much that's changed over the years. I mean, you said it earlier in the pod, but teams like Perth, for example, getting thousands of fans in and packing into like these big arenas. And what do you reckon the next step for BBL is to be able to get to that kind of level, do you think?
Yeah, I think clubs having their own arena is massive, because I think if you have your own arena, your budget could be bigger, because you don't have to rent facilities, you don't have to rely on anyone else to sort of have your court, you know. So I know that if each club can have their own arena, it would be a massive thing. I think with British players bringing them back in and having a culture where you can keep guys for sustaining a culture for a few years, you know, you can sign guys to multiple year contracts where they know that they're able to be settled, and it's a club and a league where there's not player changeover constantly. You know, as a basketball player, we don't get played like football players, you know. I don't know what people think, but we don't. So I feel like if you give players the sustainability, then they're going to want to play here. But when you have a league, which it used to be, where there's chopping and changing all the time, it's just no one really wants to play here, you know. So I think the league's got a lot better with that. I think teams getting their own arenas, I think being on YouTube, all the games, I think it is going in the right direction, you know. But I think everyone needs to jump on board and not try and find the negatives, because it's so easy to find negatives in anything, you know. Just try and find the positives in the BBL, because it has got better since I first got into this.
Yeah, I do think the BBL still has a very long way to go to get anywhere near where NBL is. But you're right, like building cultures, having players that can come in on multi-year deals, building an environment that players want to grow with the club as well, I think is massive. Like I say, funding is a big part of it. I do think like the BBL needs to do better at securing private funding as well, because the government aren't going to issue funding to the BBL. That's how it's going to be. Like there needs to be work done internally, I feel, to get sponsorship, to get TV revenue. And they're making small steps, like you say, like the games being on YouTube is a massive help. And I think also like clubs need to work a bit more on putting the same amount of input into their back office, like the same as they do with their playing staff. Like, because it's good to have a team that's successful on the court, but like you say, if you're chopping and changing players, if you bring in a member of full-time staff and they're on like a contract, then they're not going anywhere. Like they're going to be there year after year, and they can really help the team grow. And I think a lot of clubs don't necessarily have people that are able to be full-time just for basketball to help it get to the place where it needs to be.
Yeah. No, I completely agree. It feels like since I've been in here, it feels like the clubs have a small amount of employees, and it feels like those employees all have different hats where they're trying to juggle everything, you know? And I think if we get to a point where you can have a single hat for each person, that they can do that, and then they can grow the club as one and then the league as a whole, I think that's a massive part. I know with like London, you got Vince. It seems like Vince does everything for the whole of London Lions, you know? He's in every pool. He's got his foot in every door, which is great. But I think with their franchise, they've got such a great franchise that he could need some help, you know? So I think if we can grow those bigger clubs, we can grow those smaller clubs, and then the league will flourish. But the league needs to also try and get those sponsorships on board and grow from within as well.
Yeah, I remember Vince saying that with their new funding, obviously they've got the new ownership now on board at London, as they want to really focus on that front office staff. And I think that's the one piece that's missing from that club, because now obviously playing on the European stage, you need that staff to be able to manage everything. But like the team they've brought in this year, it's stacked with talent. And I'd really, for the sake of the BBL, I'd love them to be able to really push on now in European competition, and hopefully really push for that regular season spot in the Champions League as well.
Yeah, I can't wait to watch them play in Europe, because they have a deep roster, and that's what you want. You want your top teams to be fantastic, you know, and I feel like they've recruited really well. Vince has done a great job. I think I'm excited for them to play, and I just hope they do well, because I know Leicester did it. They were really close. They had some really competitive games, but they just couldn't get over the line. Hopefully this year, London can win one, win two, just see what happens from there.
Just to sort of slowly start to wrap things up, looking ahead to this season coming out with Flyers, what are your goals for this season? How much are you looking forward to kind of getting back out there? Because it's just been so long, isn't it, without basketball?
Yeah, it's been ages. I'm just excited to get around the guys, meet some new players. You know, I've obviously played against a lot of these guys that are returning for the last few seasons, so it's going to be good to meet them, to sort of go to war with them when you add a couple of imports in and whatnot. I think we're going to be a good team. You know, we've got a culture there, obviously, that Andreas has built. We've got a good fan base that are passionate about Bristol Flyers, so hopefully you can get back into that final spot and then start building from there.
Do you kind of see yourself, I know you signed on a 2-year deal, but how do you kind of see your future playing out? Do you see yourself kind of settling down in Bristol now, or?
Yeah, I mean, I like Bristol. Obviously, that's the move as well, with Sadie's work and our love of the city, you know. So we want to be around it. And for me, playing basketball, I just want to do something I enjoy, you know. So as long as I enjoy playing basketball, as long as I can get up for it, and it gives me a smile, basically, I want to keep playing. So I'm enjoying myself over here. So I'm just going to do as much as I can for the Flyers, which it is now, and just keep trying to enjoy my basketball.
Yeah. Well, Josh, let's wrap things up there. I mean, thank you so much for your time. You've been an amazing guest. Looking forward to getting back out there on the court really, really soon.
Absolutely. Thanks for having me, mate. Looking forward to it.
This is the Bristol Flyers Podcast.